Hello there. ABBA dominated the disco scene for more than a decade with hits like Waterloo, Dancing Queen, and, of course, Mamma Mia. Then came the breakup in 1982, and we hadn't heard from the band since. So it was quite the shock when a new album was announced after 40 years. It's finally out. Fans are excited. And the critics? Well, Zeynep has more on them.
I still have faith in you.
And fans have faith in ABBA. They unknowingly had to wait 40 years for the quartet to release their new album, Voyage. And they're absolutely loving it. One fan tweeted, "Being alive while an ABBA album is coming out is the peak of my existence." Another one said, "The most remarkable thing about Voyage is that it's new ABBA. That's still perfectly ABBA after all these years, but you haven't heard it 1,000 times yet." Some critics echoed similar thoughts too. Ben Cardew from Pitchfork says the band has managed the impossible by balancing the lure of nostalgia with the pull of the present day. But not all agree. The Guardian's Jude Rogers called the album a disappointment and added that it prefers to languish in often bafflingly retrograde settings. While Neil McCormick from The Telegraph said, "There's nothing here that strikes the pure gold seam of their classic 45s. So whose critic should we listen to? Well, perhaps the best advice is in the plea placed in the band's lyrics. Bjorn Ulvaeus, one of the band's songwriters, says they also acquired some knowledge and wisdom in the past 40 years. For him, it was important to reflect that in the new songs.
We decided early on that we won't, you know, look at what other people are doing today. We won't speculate in trends. We'll just do it the way we did. And whether it works or not, it's up to the audience, but we've done our best as we are now, in the age that we are now. And it's up to the audience to see whether they like it or not. And of course, it doesn't sound like Drake, but it sounds like ABBA.
And it will probably be the last album that will, because Ulvaeus added that this is it. There won't be a follow-up album. So Voyage seems to be more of a bon voyage, or at least a final cap on the band's legacy.
Let's talk to Gary Collins. He is the editor of the ABBA fan club magazine. Hi there, good to have you join us today. So it has been almost 40 years. Was the new album Voyage worth the wait, you think?
Well, I think the fans are absolutely thrilled that the new album has come out. They've only had a few days to listen to it, as you probably know. It's very recent, but there's been a lot of anticipation. All the fans have been very curious to know how the songs will sound. And I think what they have discovered is there is a big variety of songs, some slow ones, some fast pop songs, some folk tunes, and some in between, really. So a big mixture, lots to choose from.
Okay, speaking of this mixture, would you say that this album sounds exactly like the ABBA we know, we remember from the 80s, 70s?
For me, yes. From the 1980s, they were already a very mature sounding band. If you think of the big pop songs they had in the 1970s, like, for example, Waterloo, they had already moved on from that sound. Their songs were much more mature. They had a lot more depth. There was a lot more singing about their emotional life, divorce and separation, themes like that. And that's carried on to this album as well. So even though it's been 40 years between albums, I think the sound between the last album and this one is not so great. So I think the fans and the music fans will recognize that, yes.
Mm-hmm. I mean, these songs from the album could have been recorded 10, 20, 30 years ago, right?
Exactly that, yes. They are timeless. ABBA are not following the big pop stars today, like, for example, Ed Sheeran, Adele. ABBA are not following the trends of what is happening now. They are very much rooted in their own musical tradition and what they grew up with all those years ago. Mm-hmm. And they have carried that with them. And I think there is a big influence of Swedish music, but also German music, French music, British music. It all comes together with ABBA. And they are very true to themselves. Indeed they are. Yeah.
Okay, let me try to challenge you here. Just like you said, these songs were written absolutely trend blind, as the members of the group also put out in a recent interview. Do you think this is a good thing for a pop band? I mean, it's a pop band at the end of the day. Do you think, can they really exist in their own bubble, or do they have to be relational to other pop groups and trends as well?
I think the thing with ABBA is they always did exist in their own bubble, because they were making their music in Stockholm in Sweden, where the other big places for pop culture would have been London, New York, maybe Los Angeles, certainly not Stockholm. ABBA were on their own in Stockholm. They were creating their own thing. And because they were further away from everyone else musically, I think they developed their own sound and they stayed with it. So I think for them to have done anything else would have been entirely wrong. It wouldn't have sounded like ABBA.
Okay, well, for people, who didn't grow up with ABBA's music or who are not as familiar to ABBA's music as you are, how would you describe why you're such a diehard fan? Why is their music so different to you? Because, I mean, I guarantee you, there are a lot of people who don't understand this craze about ABBA. I mean, pretty much anyone under the age of 40, I guess.
Maybe, yes, although I think the band do find new fans. But for me, it's all about the link between the music and the voices. I think their music is quite classical, almost in a way. When I remember the very first song I heard, which was SOS, 1975, and I was 11 years old, and the classical notes in that song really went into my ear. And then when I heard the voices of the two women, Agneta and Frida, their blend of sound. And when that mixed with the music, it all came together in one magical bubble. And that's the only way I can describe it, really. It's the music and it's the voices and it's the mix of everything. And for me, that's in nearly every song that they've recorded since. They just find a way to put their magic together. And that's what works for me. I think that's the only way I can describe it, really.
All right. Gary Collins, the editor of the ABBA Fan Club magazine. It was lovely having you with us today. Thanks so much.
Oh, it's a pleasure. Good luck. Thank you.
Broadway's longest running show, The Phantom of the Opera, reopened after an 18-month lockdown, bringing cheers, hope, and inspiring composer Andrew Lloyd Webber to be the after-party DJ.
New York's Broadway theaters, the lifeblood of the city's tourism industry, are finally filling up again with music, dance, and cheers.
To show the world that Broadway is back.
For The Phantom of the Opera, which first opened at the Majestic Theater in 1988, making it Broadway's longest-running show, it has been an especially emotional return, the show having abruptly closed on March 12th of 2020 as some cast and crew members fell sick.
Dressing room.
Lead actress Megan Picerno spent 2020 living in North Carolina with her parents and claiming unemployment benefits. Now, after weeks of rehearsal, with plenty of health protocols in place, she is finally back on stage.
Let's go, man! I mean, when I first came here for my costume fitting, I cried the whole way here. I cried when I saw the chandelier. I cried in the company office. I cried downstairs putting on my clothes. I cried seeing everyone for the first time.
Opening night last week drew none other than the show's famed musical composer, Andrew Lloyd Webber, who even DJed at the after party. Webber told Reuters he managed to find a silver lining in the show's more than 18-month break.
This does give me the opportunity to reset the dial. It gives the whole production a chance to re-rehearse as if it's a new show from scratch.
The reset also means vaccinations, weekly testing, and daily health questionnaires for all involved in the production, not to mention a lot more laundry for the many lavish costumes, says production tailor Annette Lovis.
We will be cleaning costumes between shows. We'll be running a lot more laundry. We'll be sending things to the dry cleaner more frequently than we did before. There'll also be differences in spacing backstage. We're going to try to keep people not as close together, which is a challenge, right, because it's so crowded back here.
Just a few blocks away, the Disney musical Aladdin was forced to close for 2 weeks soon after its September reopening due to some actors testing positive, leaving all who work on The Great White Way acutely aware of the stakes and just how special this moment is.
A festival goer has sued Travis Scott and Drake following the stampede at their Texas concert. 8 were killed and dozens injured in a crash that occurred just as the concert started. Both rappers are being sued for inciting mayhem. The plaintiff, Christian Pratis, is also suing the organizers. Pratis claims security guards ignored calls for help. Disney's Eternals is the first Marvel Cinematic Universe movie to rank rotten on Rotten Tomatoes, scoring 48% on the tomato meter. Audiences also gave it only a B, a lower grade than any other movie in the franchise. But it still opened at $71 million in ticket sales in the United States over the weekend. This is the fourth highest opening of the pandemic. A copy of Mona Lisa is set to be sold at an auction in Paris. The rather fateful copy dates back to the 1600s. The auction comes months after another 17th century copy of the painting sold for over $3 million. The estimated price for this imitation is around $200,000. Fjord Oslo Light Festival has lit up Norway's capital. The festival transformed the city's harbor promenade into a large-scale outdoor exhibition. The event includes projection on buildings, light sculptures, and immersive videos. The aim is to bring people and art into the streets in a dark time of the year. Dutch art and design museum Boymans van Beuningen has put the bulk of its collection on view to the public. Most of it is normally kept in underground storage. Now, the artworks are on display in a mirrored warehouse called The Depot. Here, people can explore the art at random and get information about works on an app or by scanning a QR code. The Global Grad Show, an initiative by the Art Dubai Group, has opened its 7th edition in Dubai. The event is designed to encourage university graduates from all over the world to offer solutions to help solve major social and environmental issues. This year, 150 ideas from over 70 countries are on display. Dozens of artistic events are taking place all over Istanbul's famous Beyoğlu district. It's all part of Turkey's efforts to throw a festival following what seemed like an endless lockdown period. Nursena went on a mini road trip and here's what she saw.
Beyoğlu. Famous for Istiklal Street, Taksim Square, the Galata Tower and Bridge. It's also one of Istanbul's oldest districts and it contains several historic neighborhoods. After strict lockdown measures, the Turkish Ministry of Culture and Tourism is celebrating a new normal with a two-week-long culture festival. Spread across 64 locations, Beyoğlu Culture Road Festival offers dozens of exhibitions, concerts, workshops and talks. And we've got a taste of what's happening by picking 5 events. First,
we go to the heart of Taksim Square.
This is the Atatürk Culture Center. After a 13-year break, the building has recently reopened. Housing theatre plays, opera, library and exhibitions, it's the first stop of the Culture Festival. Let's take a closer look.
And we're here for the Tankut Oktam's retrospective exhibition, a Turkish sculptor known for his monumental works.
Tankut Oktam's works, spread across all over Turkey, are very well known by the locals, especially the ones with Mustafa Kemal Atatürk, the founder of the Turkish Republic. For most Turkish people, Oktam's works come to mind when they think about Atatürk. And the Culture Center reopened with this retrospective exhibition to pay homage to the sculptor.
In his works, Tankut Oktam depicted Atatürk and the history of the Republic. His monuments tell the story of those days. He's a sculptor who helps the new generations learn about Turkey's victory through his artworks. Yes, he's depicting Atatürk a lot, but in these monuments you can never see him alone. Tankut Oktam always depicted Atatürk with soldiers, farmers, children, animals, and the elderly next to him. He sculpted them all together to show the people's sacrifice and struggle during those years. Oktam wants us to see the people next to Atatürk. The entire nation won the war together.
Oktam's famous sculptures are usually big. He aspired to make pieces as tall as buildings, some of them reaching up to 65 meters in height. Although the sculptor also produced many abstract works about motherhood, love and unity, his monuments made him famous. His eldest daughter and the co-curator of the exhibition, Pınar Oktam, says they wanted to focus on Tankut Oktam's family and early life education to show who he is to the Turkish people.
These sculptures define our cities and town squares, so we thought people should know the life and artistic journey of the man behind it all. We hope people who see this exhibition will connect to Tankut Oktam on a deeper level, having seen his other sides.
Pınar Oktam says, despite their size, his works aim to evoke the feelings of love and companionship. And she adds that love has been the overarching theme of the curatorial process, adding an emotional take on the country's historical art scene. And on to a new location. We move from sculptor to digital art.
Galata Port is a cruise ship port, but the complex also contains exhibition galleries, luxury brand stores, and an unmistakable view of the Bosphorus.
But we're not here for the sunshine and the turquoise view of the Bosphorus. Instead, in one of the exhibition galleries is a digital exhibition called Monet and Friends. The projections take the visitors to the 19th century, examining the famous Impressionist paintings and their masters. Categorized by their color palettes, works of Monet, Pissarro, Renoir, Cézanne, and other painters are displayed. And in between different themes, the prominent art techniques and the distinguishing features of the artists are explained by short texts and quotations from the artists themselves. Debussy and Tchaikovsky's well-known pieces accompany the immersive art experience. So it's very likely to see the visitors starting to sway into the music while enjoying the paintings. From one colourful exhibition to another. The French Institute of Istanbul displays a photography exhibition called Vegetal Fantasy. The premise of the show is reminding people of the climate change and the urgent help the nature needs. Spread over the Institute's garden are French photographer Jeff Leal's flowers with their digitally enhanced colours. When I asked him why he tempers the natural lighting with the colouring of the nature, he says he's merely using the tools of the 21st century to tell its story,
and that he found out people respond much more positively when they're captivated by bright colors.
When I show you a picture of a tree, you see a tree, and that's all. You see, oh, the light is beautiful, but it's a tree. If I change the color, you see another dimension. You see more colors than the tree. But when you give the association between the colors and the tree, you see another thing. 1 + 1 is 3.
The reason why people resonate more deeply with digital colors is very human, he says. Leal things, that's because colors are strongly associated with emotions, and that the language colors and emotions speak is a universal one. He adds that in today's deteriorating climate, we need to care about nature now more than ever. So he's taking whatever measure needed to raise awareness to the issue.
Don't forget, plants come from 1 billion years before. Maybe the plants are our ancestors, the most old ancestors of all the human beings, all the life in the world. For this reason, we need to respect them, we need to love them, and we need to re-nature with this, the trees, the plants, the flowers, all the life.
Leo thinks in order for people to start respecting the Earth, they need to see the planet in a different light, both figuratively and literally. From digital flowers, we move to traditional ones. When you go to the newly opened Taksim Mosque's basement, an exhibition space welcomes you. This round gallery room resembles the rest of the mosque. And just like entering the praying area, you're required to take off your shoes. Some of the most famous Anatolian and Islamic art movements are on display. Marbled papers, ceramics, calligraphy, wooden engravings, and more. And the artists are selected from both renowned and establishing artists. And finally, a contemporary touch to a historical location, Taksim's Maksim. During the Ottoman Empire, the Taksim district was distributing the whole city's water supply. Taksim literally means to distribute. And this building, Maksim, was the busiest and fanciest nightclub in the 60s and 70s. After years of renovation, the building changed multiple times since the 90s. And now, on the ground floor, an exhibition aims to capture the essence of the life at Taksim. Artworks try to copy the sounds and the signs of the busy streets of Taksim. Addressing the many changes in the district's and the building's history, the exhibition tackles objects and concepts transforming meanings over time, and how people keep giving different meanings to the same concepts.
The word entanglement is the theme of the exhibition. It's something that closely focuses on the relationship between the objects and people and the deep meanings people attribute to objects. We're talking about how objects and people interwin with to each other. They entangle. So here you see the different interpretations of entanglement by 11 artists.
One of the works is on the walls. The same poem is translated by 6 different people, and each have a different way of interpretation. Although the grammar rules are the same, when it comes to interpretation, there are so many ways to look at the same thing.
To give an example of entanglement, the stone that you see on the floor is actually a construction material. But if you take it and throw it at someone, it will be a weapon. At the end, it can have different meanings in different contexts. All objects that you see here are entangled objects that can act as a bridge between various meanings.
tin cans as piggy banks, railroad sounds as an artist's childhood memory, hotel signs as a promise of a good time. This exhibition tries to show as many meanings to the same thing as possible. Much like Taksim, housing diverse and lively places, concepts and people all together. The Culture Festival similarly has the same vibe, diverse and chaotically lively. Anyone who has ever visited Istanbul might easily connect the city's energy to the festival's overall themes. With this culture festival, the local authorities wish to introduce newly launched galleries to the locals, as well as let the newcomers enjoy the historic background of the city.
That's it on this episode of Showcase. Our YouTube channel, Instagram and Twitter accounts have more from the world of culture and the arts. I'm Elif Bereketli. Thanks for watching. Bye for now.